everyone, welcome back. I realize this was kind of a weird place to leave off last time, but as I've mentioned before, I have a little bit less time to work on these videos these days, so we're gonna just do the best we can with what we've got. We're gonna proceed with our exploration of Sen's Fortress here. I'm gonna try and get to some questions and comments in the meantime. And really, from this point on, this is when Sen's Fortress really starts getting crazy. In this room, we've got a Serpent Man hiding around the corner and a trap switch on the floor. And we can use this trap switch to kill the Serpent Man. Well, that's what I was hoping to achieve anyway. It didn't quite work out the way I'd planned. But all's well that ends well, right? Alright, so one of the things about Sen's Fortress that you'll probably have noticed up to now, especially in the last episode, is that boulder trap. And you'll hear just now a rotating sound. The trap is actually just around the corner to my right and up one floor. And it will actually rotate to track you. It will start throwing boulders down the path you're closest to. And this is to sort of impede your progress and get in your way. And I was asked in the comments of the previous episode when I was explaining the boulder trap throwing boulders at you while you were trying to rescue Logan, someone said, well, wait a minute, that doesn't make any sense. Why not just aim the trap away? And that is possible. I get the impression, though, that the area was designed with the intent that the boulder trap would target you automatically while you were trying to rescue Logan. That doesn't actually happen. And I'm not sure if that's a programming oversight or if it was intentionally cut from the game. But as it is, the fact that the trap doesn't track you on that path kind of defeats the entire purpose of that whole area's setup and configuration. You end up never even having to worry about the boulders while you're going to get it. I was also asked about a couple of these items that are visible from the path just after the entrance of Sen's Fortress. This is one of them. You can actually see the covetous gold serpent ring from that first bridge with several swinging guillotines and the Titanite demons below. And this here, infamously, is probably the first mimic you'll encounter in the game if you take the path that most people on their first playthrough will take. You can tell this is a mimic because the chain on the right side of the treasure chest is lying in a slightly different position, and the chest has a lock on it. I believe the chests that are mimics have a slightly different texture as well. They look a bit older and shoddier. Now, mimics are interesting in this game because, first of all, each one contains a specific item that they're guaranteed to drop. And in this mimic's case, it's a lightning spear. Each mimic also has a very small chance of dropping the symbol of avarice, which is a headpiece that looks like a treasure chest, an open mimic fanged treasure chest. And it increases your item drop rate and your soul acquisition percentage, but causes you to slowly lose health over time. The lightning spear is not quite as good as the demon spear if you happen to buy one from Shiva, but it's considerably easier to get. It requires a little bit less running around and quite a bit less defeating really hard enemies early in the game. So, you could also argue that the demon spear is not good enough to make it worth getting over the lightning spear when the lightning spear is just pretty much right along your path through the game anyway. Now, my first time fighting this mimic, I was very careless about where I fought him in this room, and he actually kicked me into this elevator shaft and then jumped in after me and died, and I lost his drop. So, you gotta be careful. You also have to be careful not to ride the elevator all the way up, because if you look carefully at the ceiling of the elevator shaft, it's filled with spikes, and it will do a lot of damage to you if you stay in the elevator anywhere beyond this stop. Also, you can see into a cell below us from here. Fairly obvious that there is an accessible area down there as well. I don't believe I ended up getting to it in this episode, but ultimately I'm going to be coming back anyway to deal with Griggs, because several people were kind enough to remind me. I mentioned that I had forgotten where he goes after he turns hollow. Several people reminded me that he ends up here. So I'm going to just come back later after I've bought all of his stuff, and gotten some of his dialogue at Firelink Shrine now that we've rescued Logan. I also mentioned in the previous episode that one of the paths for these boulders sends them harmlessly out a window into nothing. This is it. And this is a really elaborate trap. It's interesting that these boulders fall in and get rammed by a humongous log, I guess, and they go flying out one of four exits. And aiming the trap in this direction essentially allows you to safely explore the other three paths, most of which you've already been to at this point, but changing the direction of that trap from here allows you to then destroy the wall below leading to Logan if you hadn't already handled it the way I did in the previous episode. Another crossbow trap there, a particularly nasty one as well if you're not paying attention and you just run into it. And this, probably the most dangerous of the guillotine traps in Sen's Fortress, because there are four of them all together and you have to run through all four at once. You can't take your time and go through one at a time here. I thought here that I might be able to hit some of the Serpent Men on the other side of this bridge. Also a very narrow bridge, so really pretty devious stuff. This is one of the reasons I feel like Sen's Fortress is so much fun, is just because they throw all these traps at you and you really have to be pretty clever about how you approach them. The traps force you to take your time, so they're really kind of trying to tell you with the level design, look guys, don't YOLO this. Now you're gonna have to apologize, you guys are gonna have to forgive me for some really shoddy gameplay for the next few minutes. I don't really know what was going on here. I was just, I was relaxing as I was playing this, and not really paying too much attention to what I was doing, because I wasn't terribly concerned about showing off for the purposes of, you know, a super neat and tidy LP. And I was kind of half distracted. I had a cup of tea nearby, and I was kind of leaning over to take sips of that. Speaking of which, I'm going to do that right now. This is another one of the items I was asked about in the comments of the previous episode. This is the Slumbering Dragon Crest Ring, and it's fairly lightly guarded. There's only one Serpent Man out here, and getting him to fall into one of these pits is fairly easy business as well, so not terribly hard to deal with him. But going this route does require you to backtrack. Now this ring, this is really handy, especially in combination with the Ring of Fog. The Ring of Fog makes you visually close to invisible, and the Slumbering Dragon Crest Ring causes you to make no noise whatsoever when you move. So both of these rings in combination allow you to very, very easily sneak up on enemies for backstabs. Problem with using both of them, though, is that you sacrifice the Hornet Ring for a backstab bonus, so you have to make a sacrifice one way or another, and the Slumbering Dragon Crest Ring is worthless in PvP, because even if you're wearing the Ring of Fog to go along with it, it puts these stupid-looking blue spheres on your feet that basically are like a humongous flag saying, hey, look! I'm all stealthed up, but I'm over here! You can see me anyway! Which is just, I don't know. I don't know what they were thinking. It's not great design. Let's just put it that way. Also, the tea I have today. This is one of my all-time favorite varieties of tea. This is Harney & Sons Chai. They call it chai. Technically, I think this would fall under the category of masala chai. It's the, I think it's the South Indian, I believe, variety. That's, it's got Assam as a base, and then it's spiced with cardamom, cloves, several other spices that I can't remember off the top of my head. But really a wonderful tea, and I had also wanted to show here, it is possible to just run straight up to the trap room without getting hit by the boulders, as long as you have maximum mobility, and just wanted to demonstrate that for people who thought that it could not be done. It can. You can completely bypass the path that takes you past the Mimic, and just run right up here and reset the trap. But chai, or masala chai anyway, is a tea that's traditionally, it has milk or cream added to it, and often sugar or honey. And ordinarily, I prefer my tea black. I do not drink it with sugar, and I never drink it with milk. But masala chai is one of those varieties that it's kind of meant to be drunk with milk and sometimes sugar. So usually what I'll do when I'm drinking masala chai is I'll add a very small amount of fresh cream and maybe a single cube of demerara sugar. I don't like my tea too sweet. And unfortunately, I am out of cream at the moment, so I am drinking this black with only a single cube of sugar for the entire pot, which is just about enough for me, I'd say. But the depth of flavor in masala, because it has so many of these really rich and flavorful, pungent spices in it, I appreciate pure tea. Like, I'll just drink straight Assam, or Gyokuro, or matcha. You don't ever, ever add anything to matcha anyway, but sometimes I'll just drink straight tea. But I appreciate flavored varieties as well. I like some of Harney & Son's flavored varieties. I like their vanilla black and the vanilla Camaro variety, the only difference being one is decaffeinated, and many of their other flavored varieties as well. I've talked about it a bit before, but really a wonderful tea for a relaxed LP of a Souls game. And I'm going to finish my cup of tea here. Ah, man. There is no better way to enjoy an evening than a good hour of Souls and a nice cup of tea. Granted, the hour of Souls and the nice cup of tea were done on separate evenings, although, come to think of it, I was drinking tea when I recorded this, so I guess technically they were done on the same night as well. But I'm recording the post-commentary for this a couple of days after I recorded the footage, so I guess, I've had tea on both nights. I don't know, guys. In my advancing age, my memory is not what it once was. Not that it was ever that great to begin with. In any case, you don't want to fall down here. That just leads down to the same spot where I got the Slumbering Dragon Crest ring, but it's twice the fall height, so no point to going down there from up here. So there across the way is the giant feeding boulders into the trap, and if you attack him even once, you can either just jump over there and get his attention up close, or shoot an arrow or a crossbow bolt at him. He will stop dropping boulders into the trap until you've either rested at a bonfire or left the area and returned. And that will allow you to explore the area below with complete impunity at no danger of being killed by the boulder trap. That giant firebomb that just blew up near me was thrown by a second giant up on the roof. And that second guy, it's really worth going up there to get rid of him. I always go take him out. Usually I ignore the guy putting boulders in the trap, because by the time I reach the roof, there's nothing else I need to do on the lower levels of the fortress. I've already cleared out the Titanite demons, I've already rescued Logan, I've already picked up whatever rings I want to get, the Covetous Gold Serpent Ring and or the Slumbering Dragon Crest Ring, the latter of which I rarely, if ever, use anyway. But by the time I get up to this part of the fortress, I don't have any need to backtrack generally, which is nice. I like that they allow you to just clear the area as you go and not have to go back and do things in two or three or four runs through the area. Couple more Baldur Knights down here, and actually, these guys seem to have a better drop rate on the Baldur side sword, and they're much more conveniently located near a bonfire than the ones in the church are. So when I farm for the Baldur side sword, I tend to prefer farming these guys. Didn't do so great with my parry timing here, unfortunately. And I put on the, what was it, the Covetous Gold Serpent Ring? I don't see my memory, God. but I put on the ring in hopes that maybe one of them would drop a shield. But I had forgotten that the merchant up at the top of the fortress here actually sells the Balder shield. So, unless you want one really, really, really early on, there's no point in trying to farm the Balder Knights for it, because you can just buy it when you get here. And by the time you get here, you should have been able to save up enough Titanite to be able to get some good levels into that Balder shield. You can also, if you have either the Dragon Torso Stone or the Force Miracle, and I think Wrath of God might work for it too, you can actually deflect the gigantic fire bombs thrown by that giant up on the minaret there. Now that giant, I should mention, up until about patch 1.02 or 1.03, I think? Somebody will remind me in the comments. It was a while ago. I don't remember. It was one of the earlier patches, but in the base game, before any real changes were made via patches, that giant would track you with his firebombs in real time, and he would actually throw them ahead of where you were going. So it was almost impossible to get out of the way of those things. Like, he would throw them with such good tracking that you almost didn't have time to move from one target zone to the other before he had already switched targets and was aiming where you were heading. So if anybody ever decides to play the unpatched version of the game and comes up here, be warned. Be warned, this place is much, much more dangerous with that guy constantly bombarding you. Like, as it is now, it takes him forever to catch up with you and start throwing bombs at your current location. He ends up being way, way behind you on that, as you can see. Another Berenica Knight here. This one does respawn, unlike the one down below in the church. Unfortunately, he cannot be backstabbed. So you just have to do the best you can with what you've got. And not get greedy, because I just got the shit stunlocked out of me. That mace, man. One hit away. Well, it's my own fault. Once again, I wasn't really paying terribly close attention, and I thought I could get in that last hit, but I ran out of stamina just a little bit too soon. C'est la vie. So, let me get back to my list here, because I did want to get to a couple more questions. I was asked quite a while ago, and I apologize to whomever asked this, because I don't even remember whom it was. I think I got this question more than once, but a couple of people had asked, I had mentioned I wanted to study in Japan. People had inquired as to what I wanted to study. I want to study the language. I want to improve my level of fluency so that, ideally, I can get to a level of fluency where I will be able to, for example, serve as a translator. And part of the reason I want to do that is for the sake of my work at Future Press, because many of the games that are made these days are made in Japan. And for the purposes of our work, often when we work with a developer, that developer will be based in Japan, like FromSoft, for example. And when we were working on the Dark Souls 2 guide, the language barrier became an issue. And for the most part, Marcus and I ended up doing the bulk of our sort of day-to-day translation. Many of the developer documents that we got were either completely in Japanese, or we would get them both in English and Japanese, and the Japanese documents would reveal things that the English translations of those same documents that we were provided by FromSoft did not. And we do have a part-time Japanese translator who is native Japanese, Hirofumi Yamada, I believe his name is. And he's obviously a very talented guy at translating, but he was on vacation for a good chunk of the time we were working on the Dark Souls 2 guide. And so while he was away, Marcus and I pretty much had to handle the day-to-day translations in his stead. And I felt horribly insufficient when I was doing that, because as I discussed in the previous episode, my level of fluency in Japanese is not great. I'm self-taught. And I don't know if I've ever told this story on my channel or not. I'm completely disregarding poor Prince Rickard here. For those of you who've only played Dark Souls 2 and were wondering where Rickard's rapier came from, it's this guy. This guy is Prince Rickard. Somehow ended up here. I don't think I had the presence of mind to check the description of his rapier when I acquired it here, but I'll try and remember to do it in the next episode, and I'll be able to show you guys his sort of backstory, which is all described in the flavor text for his sword. But the way I learned Japanese, I actually, for a number of years, I played Final Fantasy XI. And I played from the time I was in high school back in the United States for, I think, about 8 years, which is kind of sad in some ways. And over the course of my experience in Final Fantasy XI, I first heard about the game. It was my very first MMO. You know, I had heard of World of Warcraft. I knew a little bit about that, had never played it. RuneScape was a big thing back when I was in high school in the U.S. A lot of the kids in my school would go to the school library, or the media center as it was called, because that was around the time that they were kind of really getting into bringing computers into the school, and so they wanted to be, I guess, politically correct about it, but kids would go to the media center and pretend to be doing work, and they would just play RuneScape for entire class periods. And I looked upon that with such scorn, and ironically ended up playing Final Fantasy XI for the next 8 years. But when the game first came out, I was really psyched about it because I'd never played an MMO. It was a Final Fantasy game. I was a pretty big FF fanboy back in the day because, you know, most of the FF games up to Final Fantasy X I had really liked. And so I thought, oh, Final Fantasy XI? Probably going to be the same great experience I'm used to. I think I'll try it. Oh god, and now I'm going to have to interrupt that story. I promised I would talk about the sniper crossbow. Let's try and get through this quickly, but I want to make the point. Look at this thing. This is easily the coolest crossbow in the entire Souls series. Look at it! Black with gold trim, ornate, humongous, really freaking cool looking crossbow. I love this thing. It has the longest range of any crossbow in the Souls series. And it does pretty damn good damage, too. But you cannot aim it. In spite of the fact that it very clearly has a scope on it. Look at this. And I believe I showed its description shortly after this, but the description flat out says, yeah, here we go. Large crossbow with long distance used by Kareem snipers, often used with sniper bolts. And the sniper bolts are kind of the equivalent of the feather arrows. They have extended range. So, between the sniper crossbow and the sniper bolts, you should, in theory, be able to hit enemies way, way off. This thing rivals the black bow of Pharis with feather arrows if you could aim the damn thing. And I cannot fathom why nobody in this game thought to make you able to manually aim using a reticle. So, you know, I criticize Dark Souls 2 a lot, but I cannot deny that reticle targeting for crossbows was probably one of the best changes that game made. And I really cannot fathom why this is one of the things I don't understand about the design of Dark Souls 2. They removed reticle targeting for spells, for sorcery. I don't get it. It made that so much better to be able to manually aim your soul arrows with a reticle in the same way as crossbows. It was in the network test. It was in even, not the alpha, god, I don't even know what I'm thinking of, but it was in the network test anyway. And for some reason it didn't make it into the, what do you call it? God, my mind is all over the place tonight. I haven't had enough tea. I'm gonna have to go brew myself another pot when I'm done doing the commentary here, but it was taken out of the retail version of the game, I guess is what I'm trying to say. So really perplexing decision for them to add it to crossbows and have it available for spells, but then take it away from spells. So anyway, I'm going to run out of time here if I don't finish that story about Final Fantasy XI, and everybody is going to be mad at me in the next episode. So I played Final Fantasy XI for many years. I started playing in, I think the game came out in 2001, and I would have been in 10th grade then. I graduated in 2003 from high school, and the game had not come out in the United States yet. It was only out in Japan. And being the impatient young man that I was at the time, I saved up a bunch of money and purchased a Japanese PlayStation 2 and the Japanese version of Final Fantasy XI, which of course, the UI and all of the game text were in Japanese. And at that time, I had had no exposure to the language, very little, you know, understanding of the culture, hadn't researched it that much at the time. So I really didn't know what I was getting into. And a friend of mine had bought the Japanese PC version, which I have to say he spent quite a bit less money on because he didn't have to buy a console to play it on. But, I'm a classic overthinker, and I didn't have a PC at that time. So, oh, dialogue. Come on.
Ah, what? What? Who are you? Ah, another undead, eh? I took on Sen's fortress alone. But I'm no different from those vile creatures. I was driven by conceit. Ah, you think you're different? That you can handle it? Yes, I remember that feeling. For I was the same. So, let me help you out. With your soul searching. There's nothing more to say. I'm finished. We're both on the brink, you see. End of story. You bloody fool. Let me give you a nibble of advice. Don't even consider visiting an Orlando. Not in your state. For a century they've tried and failed. The Night King Rendell, Black Iron Tarkus, and even Logan himself. You won't stand a chance. You'll be eaten alive. But go along if you wish. If only to deepen your despair. Let me give you a...
So, this guy is one of the last surviving Berenica knights that have not gone hollow. As you can see, he sells some very valuable items, but at rather price-jacked rates. The Balder Shield is probably the best deal out of everything he sells. But the Katarina armor has excellent defense as well. Now, the Berenica Knights are interesting in that there are several ambiguities in the translations of their equipment. Some weapon and armor descriptions refer to them as the Knights Berenica, as here with the Great Sword. Another one that I think I'm about to show says the Knight Berenica and his heavy armor or something, implying that Berenica was a single person. And I think there's some other third translation of it, but there are at least three different variations on the translation in English, which all imply something completely different. The Japanese translation is what sheds... Yeah, see, here's the Knight Berenica, known for his heavy armor. And then I think their actual armor, which this guy sells as well, has a different description, but... The Japanese text for the Berenica Knights refers to them as the Bani Sudan no Kishi. And they have even a different name in Japanese. They're called the Burnous Knights, which is perplexing. It's not the first or only example of that in the Souls games. Many of the NPCs or figures that are mentioned have different Japanese names than they do in English. But the kanji Dan has the connotation of a military... a unit of soldiers. So, Bani Sudan implies that the Berenica Knights are an elite unit of knights. And they may well have been from the Kingdom of Baldur. This guy tells us flat out that Night King Rendell did come to Lordran, and he did attempt to traverse Sen's fortress, as did Black Iron Tarkus. And there are some fairly vague implications that Tarkus himself was the leader of the Berenica Knights, which would explain why there are so many Berenica Knights to be found in this area, both down below in the church and here in Sen's Fortress. The guy around the corner, the hollow one, and then this merchant. So clearly, they attempted together to pass through the fortress, and none of them were successful. Although, we are going to find out a little bit later that with our help, Tarkus does actually make it through.
Go along, try and make something of yourself. But nothing will come of it, and I should know.
So, enough with that guy. Back to the FF11 story, again. My friend convinced me to buy the Japanese version of Final Fantasy XI, basically. It was a friend of mine in high school. He'd been playing the game, I played a little bit of it at his house. He convinced me how much fun it was, so I picked it up. I finally got it set up, and I realized, oh shit, I can't speak or read Japanese. That's a problem! So over the course of the next 8 years, I ended up meeting a number of very friendly and helpful Japanese players in Final Fantasy XI, who were kind enough to teach me bits and pieces of the language, teach me about their culture, and in combination with that, I experimented with the UI in Final Fantasy XI. It had actually a really handy auto-translation feature, which in combination with its built-in IME, which allowed you to type Romaji, it allowed you to use Romaji input, so you could type in English characters the syllables of the Japanese letters that you wanted to enter, and it would convert your Romaji input to Japanese. So by experimenting with that, and by spending time with and conversing with and hanging out with the multitude of Japanese friends I met along the way, that's how I learned what little Japanese I know. And that's where the vast majority of my exposure to the language came from. And I, for years after that, I took great satisfaction in telling my parents, who had always kind of sort of spurned me, I guess, for my love of video games. They'd always tell me, Franz, you're never going to amount to anything in life by playing video games all the time. You really need to break that habit. You're becoming a you know, good for nothing. It was like, Mom, Dad, come on! So, now, when I go home and visit them, I kind of laugh, and I you know, they know about my YouTube channel. They check my videos occasionally. This, by the way, with the cage key, you can open this handy little elevator shortcut down to the bottom of the fortress. So, yeah, now I go home and I tell my parents, hey, so how about that not amounting to anything, huh? And they're just like, shut up, Franz. You're an ass. Of course, now, when I go home to visit my parents, I walk in. When I went to visit them this past time a few months ago in, I don't even remember, I think it was June or July of this year, I went back, and my mother picks me up at the airport, and I say, well, where's Dad? He didn't come to meet me? And she says, nah, he's home. I couldn't drag him out of the house. And we get home, and I walk in the door, and my father is sitting on the couch in his dressing gown watching Family Guy. And I'm like, Dad, you are an ex-Vopo. You were a member of arguably one of the most, if not the most, feared and hated police forces of the modern era. And now look at you, sitting on your ass in your underwear, watching American cartoons. What has happened to you? And he's just like, shut up, Franz. So, yeah, that's what I look forward to whenever I fly back to the States to visit my parents. It's usually like that. But, yeah, I don't know. I don't want to spend too much time on that, because I doubt anybody wants to hear about my dull and boring personal background, but yeah, Sen's Fortress. This place, it's a fun place, and it's a fun boss. especially considering that the NPC they give you can solo the boss on a good day. Black Iron Tarkus, the leader of the Berenica Knights, possibly. Not totally confirmed, but entirely possible and more than likely. And regardless of other factors, a complete badass. So this guy, there is a video somewhere, and I'll see if I can find it. I'll try and link it in the description if I can find it again. There is a video of somebody summoning Tarkus and walking in to fight the Iron Golem. And Tarkus not only kills the Iron Golem by himself, but actually knocks it off the fortress and gets the special kill on it. And it is just a spectacular video. It became a fad because the guy who recorded it was doing live com. I think he was streaming, actually. And when Tarkus got the kill, the guy streaming just completely flipped his lid and he just yelled, "Tarkus! Tarkus!" And it was a great moment. It was a great one. I'll try and find it for you. I also, a long time ago, made a sort of a parody video of this fight as well, where I tried to get Tarkus to do the same thing. And it kind of worked. I'll link that video in the description as well if anybody is interested. It was one of my very early videos, and I was still kind of finding my niche on YouTube, so it's not my best work. Be warned if you plan on going to watch it. But I don't know, I worked pretty hard on it. Some people thought it was funny, so for the hell of it, I'll just link it in the description of this video as well. And here, unfortunately, Tarkus probably could have actually succeeded, but he got knocked off the side of the fortress here. You can fall out of this boss room and die, but so can the boss. And that's one of the things I really like about the design of this fight. The Iron Golem, in and of himself, not really a terribly difficult fight, especially if you use the stupidly cheap strategy I'm about to use. At this point, there was really no necessity for doing something this elaborate. I could have just fought him straight up and probably been fine. But what I did here is I attuned combustion, and then put on the Dark Moon Saiyan's Ring. And the Dark Moon Saiyan's Ring gives you an additional attunement slot. Only one, though. So in that second attunement slot, I attuned Power Within. And then I cast Power Within, took off the Dark Moon Saiyan's Ring, so I lost the attunement slot that Power Within was set to, which didn't matter because I'd already used up the charge I had for Power Within. So it was no loss. And I switched out that ring for the Lingering Dragon Crest Ring, which both extends the duration of Power Within and decreases the rate at which it decays your HP. So then I had combustion attuned, and with the Bellowing Dragon Crest Ring and the boost from Power Within, it massively increased the damage from combustion. And since the Iron Golem is weak to fire, he takes much more damage from fire than from physical attacks. That in itself is a ridiculously easy way to face him without even having to use weapons at all. And very nearly anybody can do it without even leveling up, because all you need is one attunement slot. And the majority, I think, of the starting classes in this game actually start with an attunement slot without even having to dedicate any levels to it. So that's one of the things, like, I feel like the starting classes in Dark Souls 1 were much better thought out than the ones in Dark Souls 2. Not only do they all have complete sets of equipment, and I feel like each class, just the background of each class, is sort of better thought out, but they feel like complete builds to begin with, whereas the starting classes of Dark Souls 2, in some cases, they're missing pieces of equipment, they're very minimally equipped, so I don't know, it feels like you're starting the game with a character that has more substance and a stronger and more elaborate background in this game. It just feels like that to me. And in Demon's Souls, too, it feels like that. Although, Demon's Souls, I think there were somewhat fewer starting classes in that game total. But But nevertheless, in the first two Souls games, I feel like their starting classes had a little bit more individuality and uniqueness, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. But anyway, thank you guys for joining me, and next time, we are going to make our foray into Anor Londo. See you guys there!